Today, we're going to be building an OpenAI powered recipe app with no code. Let's jump in. All right, so I'm in Figma. I've just sketched out what I'd like this app to look like. Let's zoom in and have a look. So on the left-hand side, we are creating a prompt, or we have a prompt for a user. It basically says, what would you like to cook today? And then gives a hint on how they should basically answer. So just straight up with, you know, what it needs to be. Pad Thai, lamb korma, beef roast. You hit get recipe, off it goes to OpenAI. It first talks to Dolly, grabs an image of a pad Thai, whatever we are searching for, and then it will use ChatGPT to return the actual recipe. Okay, so let's do this. Let's quickly create this interface. We're going to be using Bubble, and it will be super quick. Once the interface is built, we will hook up the API and create some recipes. So I've got a page here, okay, on my layout tab. It's 576 wide, just a bootstrap standard. No biggie, but let's set up some UI. So I'm going to have a floating group. I'm going to just set up my nav bar at the top. That is going to be a row, no fixed width, no min width, and I'm going to make the height 80. In terms of the color, I'm just going to reference my Figma file here. There is the color, and let's just drop that in. Okay, there it is. On the layout tab, I'm going to set 16 pixels of left-right padding, bootstrap standard. And then I'm going to grab my icon. So I'm going to drop an image in there and then go find my icon. And paste my icon in. It looks pretty big, so I'm just going to change this to 48 pixels, put it in the center, and keep aspect ratio fixed. Now I'm just going to grab a button, put it next to it, say log in. I am just going to change the primary color to, for this particular app, I'm just going to change it there. No, to the green, we need the green. There is the green, and this will just save us a little bit of time on the styling, okay. Back in the design tab, let's make the layout not fixed width, no min width, fit width to content. And this particular button is going to be inverse. So this is going to be black and this is going to be white in terms of the styling of the button. Now I'm just going to put that in the center, and then on the row container layout, I'm going to choose the alignment space between. Okay, that's that done. Now we have two different views, of course. We have the prompt view here and we have the result view. So the result view has something different in the navbar. So let's build that out. First of all, I'm going to take these two guys here, group them in a row container, change the alignment back to space between. I'm going to remove it from page load. Let's put it here. And I'm going to collapse it with hidden, and I'm going to rename this to group navbar prompt. And we're going to be using something called parameters, basically, to change views. Parameters just allow us to control what's shown on the page in the actual URL. So if you've ever seen question mark something equals something, well, that's called a parameter. It's a key value pair, basically. It's quite basic. Let me show how I do it to create views. So on the conditional tab, I'm going to say that when getV equals empty, or when getV is empty, then show this standard default group. So I'm going to say get to get data from page URL. You can just drop in a parameter name V, you know, could be anything in there. When that is empty, then this group needs to be visible. And when I go across to Figma, I'm going to have another parameter that says when get V is prompt or result, then yeah, we'll say result, then show this other view. Okay, so I'm going to copy and paste this guy here, put it on the right hand side. And then I'm just going to say this is navbar result. And I'm going to say when get V from page URL is, and just type in with my keypad result and hit enter, then we're going to show this guy. Okay, so I'm going to grab a material icon, drop it inside just so I can add an arrow as a back button. That back button will then get us back to the prompt. on the layout tab, I'm just going to make this 24 by 24 bootstrap sizing, put that in the center and delete the icon. On the right-hand side, I want the results of what's shown, okay? So I am, or what we're searching for. I'm just going to remove this login button, leave the text in there. I'm just going to type in chicken pad Thai for now. Just give this some basic styling. Let's say that this is slightly larger, 18. It's going to be white on the green background. It's going to be right aligned. And I'm going to center that vertically. No fixed width, no min width, no min height. That's fine. All right, so that means that when we click on the back button, it takes us back to the default view. So I can say navigation, go to page, the same page, because all we're doing is changing the parameter, and then let's just have an empty V parameter with nothing in here. All right, so that takes care of the nav bar. Next, we're going to build out this section here. Okay, so let's see, we have 24 pixels row gap. What would you like to cook that has 24 pixels? All right, let's do that. So we need a group, drop the group in there. This is going to be group body prompt. All right, that's going to be a column container. As we just saw, we are going to have 24 pixels of gap spacing, no fixed width, and min height of 280 is fine for now, not that important. And when do we show it? We show it when get V from page URL. Here it is here, get V is empty, because this is the default view. So when there's no parameter, show it. Okay, so it's not visible in page load, we collapse when hidden. Great, let's grab that text, 24 pixels text. Let's just drop it inside this group. Oh, it is inside the group, that's fine. It's just the group needs 80 pixels of top margin. And then within here, it needs 16 pixels left and right padding. And then let's use 48, 48 top and bottom. Cool. So this text I've copied from Figma. It says, what would you like to cook? And I'm going to detach the style and just manually style this. Okay, on the layout tab, let it span edge to edge, as it should do because it's flex. And there we go. That's all we need. Now we need a multi-line input. Let's grab it and drop it on the page in that group and just say, what would you like to cook? And then i.e. chicken pad Thai, or maybe a lamb korma, or what about a beef roast, Sunday roast, English roast? That sounds good to me. Okay, this input should not be empty. I'm going to check that for form validation purposes. On the layout tab, I'm just going to make this, let's do 120 on this bad boy. No min width, no fixed width, edge to edge, beautiful. And grab this button, log in, paste it down. This is our get recipe button. So this is how we query the API, okay? And I'm going to make the background our primary green and just change this to the contrast white, beautiful. On the layout tab, this button will be slightly bigger at 48 pixels and it will span edge to edge because it is mobile, okay? This is sort of more of a landscape view. All right, so let's have a look at Figma again. What do we need to do next? Well, we need another group, okay? Because we need to drop in an image. Let's have a look. This image is 290 pixels tall, and we need our result, basically a piece of text that will be filled with state that we get from OpenAI. All right, so let's grab a group, drop it in. It sits underneath. This will be the result body. Going to be a column as we saw because it has an image on the top, results on the bottom. Let's span this edge to edge. No min width, min height of 280 is fine. And actually we're not going to have any padding just yet because I'm going to grab an image and I want that image to span edge to edge. But what I might actually do is just add some bottom padding of 48 just so I can access the group. All right, grab an image. I'm going to draw it into the result. And it's not going to show anything for now, but I am going to just style it very quickly. So edge to edge, and let's make this 290 tall. That's all we kind of need to do. Going back on the group, see the group is not going to be visible in page load. This is the group result body. We need to match it up with this part of the nav bar. So it's not visible in page load. It's collapsed when hidden, and we are going to show it when get v or get data from page URL with the v parameter is result. So now we have a result. Now we can populate it with something. So that's when it's visible, check. And then lastly, we need some text down here. And this is just going to say result. And this is going to span edge to edge, but we are going to put a wrapper group around it just so we can apply some padding basically. So I'm going to say group elements in a column container. And in that column container, please apply 16 pixels left and right. And that looks good to me. All right, and finally on this design, I'm just going to add some gap spacing of, let's try 24. Okay, it doesn't look like much. You know, at this stage, I probably would just put some placeholder color in here or just a placeholder image, maybe some lorem. But hey, I just want to get to this result as fast as possible. So I want to get into the data side of things, which is far more interesting. But I'm just going to have a look at Figma one more time. And yeah, confirmed that that's all we need to do for now. Okay, so I have an account with OpenAI, and you need to create an account as well. Okay, so to create that account, go to platform.openai.com and you can create your account, because we do need to get to our API keys. Before we get to our API keys, we just need to look at the API reference. So what we could have done is this. We could have gone, okay, well, I have a ChatGPT account, and I'm on this API reference, and I'm not quite sure which API endpoint to use to return an image of a chicken pad thai and a recipe. So we have something called completions, and that says, given a prompt, which we'll be doing, the model will return one or more predicted completions and can also return the probabilities of alternative tokens at each position. The main thing here is that it will return one or more predicted completions. So the completion would be the result, basically. We're asking it a question and it's giving us an answer. So that's something we can use for a recipe app. We can also use, or maybe we can use, chat, because given a chat conversation, the model will return a chat completion response. Now, the completion one makes a little bit more sense, but let's ask GPT-4, ChatGPT, what it thinks, basically. So I'm going to ask it. If I wanted to create a recipe app using OpenAI endpoints, which ones would I need for an image of the recipe plus the recipe text? Question mark. All right, so it's talking about two main services that we need. So DALL-E for generating images. Fantastic. All right, and there's the documentation. And then GPT-4 for generating recipe text. To generate recipe text, you would use the GPT-4 model. Then it's going to point us towards the documentation. Okay, so let's have a look. DALL-E. And here we go. So DALL-E basically is, DALL-E is what we use. Here we go down here. DALL-E is a system that can create realistic images and art from a description in natural language. That's what we are saying, basically, a description in natural language. Okay. GPT-4, more capable than GPT-3.5 model. It's basically just the latest model at this time. So that kind of gives us a hint. Now, we'd have to then dig down and decide Which particular endpoints do we want to use? All right, so we're going to be using the image generation endpoint. Here it is here. And we're going to be using the chat completion endpoint as well. I've run this test with other completion endpoints, and I feel like the chat one is the most advanced at this stage. So we've got chat versus completions. Similar thing, chat is obviously built for a question and answer kind of format, but you can also just ask a question and get a single answer. So we'll be using the chat API here. Okay, but in terms of the image, let's do the image generation. So here is some information about the API, and I'm going to change this to curl. Okay, this is what Bubble understands. I'm just going to click on copy. So I can individually type this in, you know, copy and paste each piece. But in Bubble, what we can also do is go to the plugin tab, install the API connector. Okay, and I'm going to add another API. This is going to be called OpenAI. Okay, and I'm going to import another call from curl. I'm going to paste in what I copied and import. Fantastic. So I can name this Dolly. And one thing I'm going to do is just change from data to action, because I am basically running it on a workflow in Bubble. And we can see we've got the post call here. We've got content type application JSON. I'm going to set that to private. And then we've got our API key. Okay, so where does this key come from? So I am logged into my account. We can see Buildcamp here, and we can see a bunch of keys or partial keys in here. I've already created my recipe app key. So all you need to do is create a new key, give it a name, and it creates it for you. And it only shows you that key once. So make sure to copy it, save it somewhere if you need to, or just paste it straight into your Bubble app. A bit safer than saving it somewhere online. Okay. So I've got my key. I'm going to go back to Bubble, and I'm going to paste my key in here. There is my key, and that's also going to be private. All right, so we want this prompt to be dynamic. So the way that we are able to dynamically change this prompt is by putting it in these brackets, like this, and then we can basically give it a key value pair. So I can just name it prompt. So in here, just name it prompt, and the value, which I'm going to uncheck private, because I want to be able to feed through a value from the multi-line input on the front end. So the prompt, I think a Siamese cat, doesn't matter what this is, basically, because we just need it to be able to see if this API call is working. All right, we can change the sizes here. There's stuff in the guides. Don't need to worry about this for now. But I'm connecting. All right, so it's returned some stuff, and we can see one of those is a URL. Okay, let me show you in the raw data. This is the image here, guys. So that is successful. So I'm just going to save that. And that's all we need to do for Dolly. So we are talking to Dolly on OpenAI now. We're getting a result. Perfect. So I'm going to collapse this guy. Now I'm going to expand this guy. No, actually, we don't need to expand it. We don't actually need that one. So that second one, I'm just going to delete, because I'm going to import from curl. All right, so I'm just going to go to the API reference, and then what we should have actually worked from here earlier. So here is the image one from the API reference, not the documentation. So basically ChatGPT took us to the docs to read more about it, but maybe we should have just gone straight to the API reference. But here it is here, the same thing, curl, copy on images. Now I'm going to go to chat. I was talking earlier about completions versus chat. The structure of the call I'm doing is more of a completion, because it's a single question and getting a single answer. ChatGPT is more about conversational back and forth. However, like I was saying previously, I feel like the chat endpoint is stronger. It gives me a better formatted recipe. I'm going to use the chat one. Okay, so I'm going to copy, make sure it's on curl, And if I go and I'm going to import another core curl, paste that in, Bubble recognizes all the stuff. Perfect. So let me just get my API key a second. All right, and I'm going to make both of those private. And this is going to be GPT-4. Okay, I've just changed that. And the only thing I need here is the content. So I'm just going to put some brackets around that, rename it to content. Uncheck private so that we can access it on the front end and say, how are you today? And let's initialize the call. All right, so we're getting a lot of stuff back. It's the choices list I'm interested in. So I'm just going to save that. I can see one change I do need to make though is I'm going to change this to an action so it's accessible in the workflow tab. And I am going to change this to ChatGPT. All right, I made a change, so I'm just going to reinitialize the call quickly. All right, great. So I'm going to show you the raw data. I asked it how it is, and it said, as an AI, I do not have emotions, blah, blah, blah. Primary goal is to assist you. Perfect. Well, that's what we want. So I'm going to save that. And now we get to hook up this API call to the front end and bring it to life. Okay, back in the design tab. Let's click on the get recipe and set up this workflow. So the first thing we want to do is go down to plugins. You can see I've got some testing ones here, but the ones I've just created was the OpenAI DALL-E and the ChatGPT. So for DALL-E, basically we can see that we have a prompt and it says a Siamese cat. We obviously recognize this from DALL-E here, where there is a prompt, that's the key, and that's the value. So what we're basically doing is feeding a new value into here, and then when we click get recipe, we're basically pinging the API to return the result. Okay, so I'm going to start at a workflow in this guy, and basically it's the multi-line input, the value of the multi-line input. Now, prompt engineering is now a thing, and I feel like prompt engineering will be a valued skill in the workplace going forward. If I had to say to DALL-E just the words, let's do chicken pad thai. Okay, again, you can't feed anything into this API, anything as obscure as you can think of, and it will create you an image and it will look pretty realistic. It will look realistic, but you do have to pad out this particular prompt with a bit more text. So I could just say chicken pad thai, and it will return me a chicken pad thai. But what about if we said something like a photorealistic zoomed out image of a chicken pad thai on a table? Because if we didn't say that, then it might give us results that are too zoomed in or a little bit obscure. We could say an overhead shot, anything we like. We could say, give me a painting of a chicken pad thai. But we're going to say a photorealistic zoomed out image. So let's add this to the prompt. So the user doesn't see this. The user only sees the prompt in the front end. So a photo realistic image. A photorealistic zoomed out image of a space. And then the user types in the particular recipe they're looking for. And then let's just say on a table. We could also say an overhead shot, a photorealistic zoomed out overhead shot of an image. All right, I'm just going to sort out some text here. Okay, so we have basically built a prompt. Part of it is dynamic. The multi-line input part is created by the user. So we've created a sandwich here. Now let's go to the next one. So down to plugins and down to ChatGPT. By the way, you won't see these in plugins unless you have successfully initialized a call from the API connector. So until you initialize those calls, you don't see anything. So just a little tip there. On the plugins tab, I'm going to go to ChatGPT. And here we go. So we recognize that. The prompt, how are you today? We just need to replace that. So we need some context. So, you know, the multi-line input will play a part. So if we had to say to ChatGPT, chicken pad thai, what's ChatGPT going to say? Let's actually try it. I'm going to change this to GPT-4. So it's telling me what it is. It's not giving me a recipe, okay? Oh, it is giving me a recipe. It's giving me a recipe, that's excellent. Wow, it's getting really smart. So I think it assumed that I wanted to know what it was, and then it's being extra helpful by giving me a recipe. So guys, this is what we are going to be bringing in to the app. So it looks like we don't even need to build out the full prompt. My original prompt was give me a recipe for, and then the multi-line input. But this is how smart ChatGPT is. I think other people may have asked about recipes, and it just knows what you're trying to, what kind of result you're looking for. So let's just do that. Let's just leave it at that. All right, so multi-line input is in there. Perfect. Next, we're just going to set some states, and I will talk about how to save the result to the database, which you should do. You should always save the result of these calls because these calls cost money. But for now, let's just set a state to the page and then show the result of that state. So I'm going to set a state to recipe to the page. First one will be called image. And this is going to be an image. Create. And where is it? Well, it's in step one. So let's grab the result of step one. So the result of step one. Data, and we're going to choose the first items URL. Okay, so data and then first items URL. Where did we see this, basically the schema? If I go to expand, and if I click reinitialize call on the Dolly call, and I click show raw data, basically there is data there. Okay, so data came back as a list. Data came back as a list. That's why we needed to pick the first item, because it was just returning one thing for us. But this is just the structure of the data that they're returning. Okay, so we had to choose data, and then because it's a list, pick the first item and then the URL in that item. Okay, so that takes care of the image. What about the actual recipe? So let's say recipe, that is text. Create. This is going to be the result of step two for ChatGPT. All right, remember it said choices. We'll go back and have a look at this. Choices. Choices is a list, so we need the first item and then message content. We can actually reduce all of these if we'd like. Let me just set message content. Let's go back and review how we figured this out. So I'm going to collapse Dolly, open up the ChatGPT, and click reinitialize call, and it will present to us this particular structure, JSON structure. So it's the result of step two, and it was the choices. Choices is a list, therefore we needed the first item in this list, all right? These are objects. And then we can see in the message content is where the text that we needed was, okay? Choices, and here is the content. So if you ever get lost, and sometimes I do get lost in these, this is one of the things that I tend to do, is just jump back in, reinitialize a call, and try to dig down and figure out, is it a list, is it not a list, where is the content? And you can usually find your way. But you can actually exclude a lot of that stuff that is returned by ignoring those particular fields as well. All right, so now that we have these states, we can populate the image with the state. So the image is set at page level and recipe, and there it is there, the image. And I'm going to just zoom in so it cuts this particular shape. And then the recipe itself is also at page level. The page is called recipe, there it is there, and it is the recipe. Okay, I'm just going to jazz up this get recipe button just because the ChatGPT API actually does take quite a while to return a result, sometimes like up to 60 seconds. If we use the completions endpoint, it's much faster, but the result isn't as good. Okay, so that's kind of the trade-off here. But I do need to show the user something when they click get recipe so that they know it's thinking, something is happening. All right, so I'm using Hero Icons. I've installed this plugin called Hero Icons. This allows me to create spinners or animations within buttons. So in the past, people have created buttons, animated buttons by using a group, putting text in a group and putting an icon in a group and then animating the icon. But Hero Icons, you can include that icon within the button itself. So I've installed that. This is something you don't really need to know, but I'm just going to set this up. So I'm going to say, what I'm going to do is when I click on get recipe, I'm just going to set a new step one here. That is going to set state to the button get recipe. This is just going to say active, and I'm just going to bookend this workflow with basically active yes and then active no. So when this button is active, I'm going to do something, then I'm going to copy and paste this, drop it at the end, and this will say no. So now that we have the state that starts at step one and ends at step five, after OpenAI has returned everything, the state will change back to the default. But what I can say is that when this button's active is yes, then just change the text to generating your recipe, and then have a little animation here. All right, you can go yourself and have a look at Hero Icons and look at the documentation, but this is what they wanted me to use here, some of this this text to get the desired result. All right, so the other thing we need to do is, so we're setting state on the button, we're querying DALL-E to get the image, we're querying ChatGPT to get the recipe, we are setting state to the page with the result of step two and step three, and then we are setting state to the button to return it back to get recipe. But we also need to go to page because we need to change the parameters, guys. So stay on the same page and just say V equals result. That then allows us to hide this group because get V from page URL is now not empty. It is in fact result. Okay, so I'm going to preview the page. And I'm going to put it in a mobile screen. There it is there. And I'm going to have a go. So let's type in chicken pad Thai. Get recipe, generating a recipe. Now this does take a while, so I'm just going to cut out this part. All right, and there we go. There is our chicken pad Thai, slightly zoomed out on a table, looks delicious. And here is the recipe. Introduction to a pad Thai, you've got your ingredients, you've got your sauce, your instructions. I mean, how amazing is this, guys? And you can obviously just hit the back button and do another search. Now, the one thing I did actually miss was the result of what we're searching. So that's absolutely fine. So what we could do here is, I mean, this is correct, but it's not dynamic. So what we do here is just say, when we click the button to get the recipe, I'm going to set another state. This state will be called prompt. That's going to be text, and the prompt is a multi-line input. All right, and then I can just go back and change this to be dynamic. I can say it is on the recipe on the page, and it is the prompt. And that's all we need to do, guys. That's all we need to do. How incredible is this? I mean, this is going to change the world. Not the recipe app, but what OpenAI is doing and other artificial intelligence driven companies. So super exciting. We're going to do a long series on recording all kind of AI related apps. Lots to come, so stick around. I hope you enjoyed that.